Testing, trusting, boot up. Is that better? Check, 1, 2. All right, well, good morning. We're gonna begin our service. If you wanna make your way to your seats. All right, can you hear me now? All right, this is the day that the Lord has made, and what? Rejoice. Let's try that again. This is the day the Lord has made, and I will what?
Rejoice and be glad.
Good, amen. Well, I'm glad you guys are here. I don't know if the other mics are on, if that's causing the feedback. Is that better? Awesome. Well, we have an exciting morning. We have a lot of neat stuff going on today, and excited to share that with you. Pastor Dan is... and Connie are out of town visiting Danielle and Trevor. So they're gone this morning, so we're going to be just lifting them up in prayer. And so missions trip. And if you guys have your bulletins, you'll see here just a couple things. Some exciting stuff, not this Friday, but the following Friday, the Center for Life Choices is going to be having our second annual worship celebration concert, opportunity that myself and along with some other worship leaders in both Lake County and Mendocino County, we've come together and compiled a worship team. And you guys, it has been so much fun practicing in preparation for this night. And it's going to be just a neat time as the body of Christ.
It's one of the unique things
where the Center for Life Choices, it brings all the churches together.
It's kind of like a reunion. And so we're really excited
about this opportunity just to celebrate what the Lord has been doing in the ministry and just come together as the body to worship Christ and to celebrate him. And so that's going to be going on April 19th. So if you want to mark your calendars for that, it will be, there's actually two. The 18th will be in Lake County at the Grace Church, I believe, Kelseyville. And so if you want to go there, and if you can't make the Friday night, but you can do Thursday night in Lake County, you're more welcome to go to the concert there that evening. And then it'll be at New Life Church right there by Burger King. Will be on the 19th. A couple other things. This morning after the service, Children's Church leaders, we are going to be having a meeting. Jake will be meeting with anybody that wants to be a part of the Children's Church ministry during the service when we have our Children's Church service. This month, Callie and Rachel and Shelly, I believe, are covering this month. Is that right? So, Jake, anything else you want to add to the meeting after church today?
No. It'll be a really quick meeting because I know, like, at least I get hungry. Right,
so, I like to eat. So, we'll make it really quick, I promise.
Yeah, and speaking of food, today is the lunch brunch. So, if you would like, after service, feel free to hang out. If you brought food, if you didn't bring food, you're more than welcome. There's always a lot left over. So, just a time of fellowship with the church family after service is lunch brunch today. And then also just a reminder, when the service is, when we finish the music time of our worship to the Lord, the children are dismissed before the message begins. So that, just, I'll say it now, Jake, so I don't forget later. Jake's like, don't forget to tell them. I'm like, I'll tell them now. And then also this morning, we have a special guest speaker, a dear friend, dear brother, Joel Thompson. Joel and his wife Kirsten and their son Jude is sitting over in the towards the middle back there. Joel's waving. You'll meet him here in a second after we get done with our worship and song time. But Joel works for me at Heartstone Bible Camp. We work together in the ministry and serving churches all throughout both counties. And he is just a faithful man of God, a dear friend, and faithful to the scriptures. And when Pastor Dan and I were talking about this particular Sunday and having the message covered, I had brought Joel's name up, and we said, let's have Joel come. And Joel, he actually has opportunities. And the Ministry of Heartstone allows Joel and I to minister to a lot of different churches around the area. So Joel and I have that privilege to serve Christ's body. And so I'm so excited to introduce him here to the Ukiah Bible Church family. And I trust that you'll be blessed as you guys prepare your hearts to hear from the Word of God this morning. So that'll be Joel. So I'm introducing him now. So when he comes up here, he'll just be able to get right into the Word with you guys. So that'll be Joel Thompson. They'll be here this morning. And then we have another special surprise this morning is the Gideons are here. And so we love the Gideons, right? Rick and Connie are here with us this morning. They have a special ministry. He's going to give you more information about that here in a second. But before he comes and shares a ministry update from the Gideons, I just want to express that there's a need that our church needs to connect with Gideons on is we need a liaison. And a liaison is basically just a couple in the church that wants to be connected to the Gideons and represent the Gideon ministry in the body life of the church. So when things are coming up and ministries are happening, they can speak on behalf of the Gideons and help there. And Rick will probably make a comment towards that. But if you feel led to want to be that liaison ambassador to the church, just like the Center for Life Choices, Carmen's like a liaison and helping communicate what's going on in the ministry there. It's nice to have those supports. So if you have a heart for this ministry, the Gideons, we love the Word of God. We're Ukiah Bible Church, right? We want to see the Word of God go forth, and we see how the Word of God has changed our lives, and we want to see it continue to change other people's lives. And so if you feel led to want to be that liaison type couple to help support, and you don't have to be a couple, I just said that. It can be an individual, whoever would like to support the Gideons and be that representative to the Ukiah Bible Church family. Be praying about that, and if you feel led to do that, you can talk to Pastor Dan or myself, and we can get you guys connected. So with that being said, I'd like to have Rick Hewlett come up and give us a little ministry update.
During a recent scripture blitz in Brazil, the Gideons there were distributing New Testaments to students coming into a very busy university, and while most were quite thankful for the gift, one young man refused it and began cursing. He was very mad, and he says, "You know what you can do with these books? You can just throw them away like I'm going to do now." And he just tossed that thing way up in the air and landed up on a building nearby. Later in that day, a very short man covered in tar appeared, and he says, "I was working on the roof of that building, working. I was contemplating, however, taking my life because I am so messed up. But you know what? A miracle happened. God dropped this Bible right on my head." And so I've taken it up. I've read in there, and it says right there, "I've read how you can have eternal life." Brothers, I want to know this eternal life. I want to have that hope, which I don't have now. So he became a brother in Christ that very day. You see, with man, things are impossible, but with God, yeah. Or I know a brother, his name is Ray Fain of the Gideon, and he shares this situation that happened just this last December. In fact, he said, "Our camp had the opportunity to distribute scriptures as part of a local church outreach that was giving away food and gifts and presents, to those who needed it." And so he was there, and he had a conversation with a young woman, a young mother. Her name is Austin. I've never heard that name before for a woman, but that was her name. She had three children, and she had come to get food and then gifts for her children. During our conversation, we started talking about Christ, he says, and I asked her if she thought she would go to heaven. And she answered, "Well, I hope so. I try really hard to do good every single day." So I asked her, "Well, when did you believe in Jesus?" And she shared that when she was 6 years old, she came to know that she needed to believe in Jesus in a Mormon church. "Well, I felt the Holy Spirit lead me to continue to share and to prompt me. So I led her through the scriptures in the back of the Testament and explained how God's gift of salvation was a free gift. It's not something you have to earn or work for. Did you do anything to get these gifts for your children today?" "No," she answered. She hadn't. "So, Austin, would you like to change from hoping you'll be in heaven to knowing you're in heaven?" tears started streaming down her face. And I showed her how to receive salvation through Jesus and offered her the opportunity to pray, which she did. When she finished, she looked up at me with the tears in her eyes and said, "I know I'll be in heaven now." See, with testimonies like that and millions of others from around the world, this is made possible because someone just like you and someone just like Ukiah Bible Church have prayed for this ministry and have donated to this worldwide effort to, you know, share the gospel. And so we want to thank you for that. We basically consider the Giddings to be your partner in ministry. We're essentially a volunteer mission group, and we're active here in this local community, including Good Friday service at New Life Church, where we gave away 18 Bibles and Testaments there. And so we just thank you so much. So some of you might not be familiar with the Giddings. Let me tell you, we are an interdenominational international association of about 250,000 Christian and professional, business and professional men and their wives. And so we're dedicated to saving the lost. And we do that through three different ways, through associating together and building each other up, training, meetings, et cetera. We do that through personal work and personal testimony. So if we're at Safeway and in the checkout line, we can offer a testament to the checker and, you know, just a brief interaction and give them some hope there. And we also do that through, of course, distributing testaments around. So we're evangelical Christians. We're members of local churches, just like UBC, and we must be recommended for membership by our pastors as well. Last year alone, we gave out around 60 million testaments around the world. And since our beginning a little over a century ago, we've just hit the 2.5 billion mark worldwide. Well, you know that we put Bibles in hotels and motels, but of that 60 million, about only 10% go into hotels and motels. What about that other 90%, right? They go one-on-one, hand-to-hand, into jails, into prisons, into hospitals and convalescent homes. The auxiliary are very active at doctors and dental offices. They also go to women's shelter, veterinary offices. And we also go to police, fire, and emergency personnel, the men and women in our armed forces, they get the camo ones, and students in colleges and schools and university. In fact, students get around 80% of all of these, including in last fall, 150 testaments on the sidewalks at Ukiah High School, and then just a couple of days later, 250 at Pomalita Middle School. So, folks, we're investing in the next generation of believers. Well, you know, as Jesus said, he didn't come for the healthy and righteous. He came for the downtrodden, the lame, the sinners who need to be made whole. And he came for a man named Pat Shelton. Let's watch his testimony right now.
What can I do that would make my daddy happy and spend time with me? I was 6 years old, and I said, I know what I'll do. I'll get him a beer. Well, I got a beer, and my fingers wouldn't open it up, so I took a spoon, and I popped it open, and I ran up to my daddy and said, look what I done, Daddy. This is for you. He said, all right, son, you open it. You drink it. That was the first time I was ever drunk. I had so much anger and rage. My dad was an alcoholic. My sister sold drugs. By the time I was 12 years old, I was selling drugs in school. By the time I was 17, I was collecting money for other drug dealers. At one time, I had 35 pounds of meth on my back, $250,000. I had 72 cops, 6 dogs, and 2 choppers after me. I was running from the law. Ended up going to jail. A Gideon named Charlie Waters came into my cell. Looked me straight in the eye and told me, Jesus loves you and I love you. I looked at him, I said, well, undoubtedly he don't know me. So one day he was telling us about this man, Jesus, and I felt this tear start coming up in my eye. And I started fighting that so hard because I was Pat Shelton. I was a man that collected money. I was a drug dealer. I collected money from other drug dealers. I was burning houses, blowing up cars. I was destroying families. Nothing made me cry. And I didn't know what to do. And Charlie came in and told me, would you do this for me? Would you read this book for me? I read the book of John, and I got over there and I got to reading about all these people. I read about Peter, and I wrote about all these people in here. And I said, they were guys, nice guys, but this Jesus has got it going on. And then I realized, this man truly died for me. And I got down on my knees and I said, Lord, I don't know you, don't know nothing about you. But if you can take this pain and this suffering, this rage and this anger from me and this addiction, I won't give you my life, I'll surrender. And right at that moment, he spoke to me and he gave me forgiveness. He said, I forgive you. Well, I came up excited. Finally got out of jail. When I got out of jail, I said, God, I'll never come back to this jail. You get me out here, I'll never come back. 1 year to the day, he called me to minister. I went back to the jail. I've been doing the jail ministry for 9 years. We've had over 800 men come out of that jail. Since then, I serve a God that's a God of restoration. He has restored my family. I led my mom and daddy both to the Lord, and he's given me a chance to go out and tell people how wonderful he is. And all this happened because of one man. One man never gave up, and that's why I'm doing what I do today, is because he loved me enough to tell me.
Well, there's a variety of ways that you can help this vital ministry, and maybe I could just suggest three ways. First and foremost, we covet your prayers. We need prayers for all of our activities, but we need prayers for more open doors. Some motels, for instance, have stopped allowing the Gideon Bibles in their drawers, which is unfortunate, but of course on the Bible apps, and we have one too, Gideon Bible app. You can read the Bible in over 2,000 languages around the world. Many people are getting the Bible that way, but we need more open doors. We need more funds to purchase these scriptures. We typically have a backlog of about 10 million scriptures worldwide that are needed by countries but are unfunded. So that would help. And also, as Dave mentioned, we need more Gideons and auxiliary to join this ministry. This is an outstanding time to join this because, you know, with COVID over, people are just really looking for something to guide and direct them. And, you know, Connie and I have found that participating in the Gideons has really done an amazing thing to our faith in our marriage. It's really increased our faith. We have become much more effective at witnessing and just sharing the gospel. It just becomes natural at this point, and of course, and in service to the Lord. We'd love to talk with you afterwards if you'd like to find out more about this ministry, and so get a hold of us. We'll be in the back. Next, we do ask that you consider giving to this ministry. This church has been very generous in the past. We thank you for that. These little testaments cost us $1.70. Worldwide, it's around $1.50 or so. With the, you know, the volume that we print up. And also, these hotel Bibles are only $6.50. And yet, this book has a potential to reach about 2,000 people in its typical lifespan in a hotel. You know, you can contribute cash, checks, or if you want to use the old fantastic credit card method, you can do that, you know, with a tear out in this bulletin. And hey, if you're super techie, you can even scan the QR code in the back. How do you like that? So there's another way that you can support the ministry as well, and that is to use our Gideon cards. These are free, attractive greeting cards for a variety of purposes. You send your friend the card, and you send the Gideons a gift for Bibles to be donated in their name. So you also might consider, if you're not wanting to be a member, but perhaps a friend of Gideon, that's another new level that we've implemented where you can pray for this ministry. You can also get your very own scriptures just like this. They just don't have the Gideon emblem on them for $2 a pop. That's not bad. And so it's a way that you can become very much more skilled at personal evangelism and a way to support this ministry. So thank you, Pastor Dave and Ukiah Bible Church. It's always a blessing for Connie and me to be here. Thank you so much.
Well, good Good morning. Thank you, Rick. I appreciate that. As many of you know, my past as a law enforcement officer, you know, we hear of that ripple effect, like throwing a stone in the water and there's ripple. Well, when I would go on patrol and I'd arrest people, I had so many people when I'd take them to jail that would say, thanks for being the coolest cop to ever take me to jail, right? But it was nothing of me, it was all of Christ. And so one time I got to meet up with the Gideons and they gave me a whole bunch of Bibles. And so as I would go, these prisoners would always ask me, what makes you so different? Now, law enforcement in the state of California says, I can't witness to them unless they open the door. Well, to me, that was an invitation right there. I said, well, what makes me different is my Lord Jesus Christ. I've been justified through him. And so because I'm justified through him, I want to serve him. And therefore, I want to serve you. And so every time they would ask me that, and every time they would go, I'd put a Gideon Bible in their possession. I don't know what those seeds possess, but that's that ripple effect that I hope that that's a lowest point for that person. They get that Bible when they get out there and they read it. So who knows what they would do, but because of faithful men and women like this and the Gideons, that ripple effect goes out worldwide. And so thank you for that little side note. But if you guys would do me a favor and open up your Bibles to Romans 3:21. And once you get there, if you would stand with me, I'd appreciate that. Romans 3:21-26. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Jesus Christ, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in his blood through faith. This was to demonstrate his righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, he passed over the sins previously committed. For the demonstration, I say, of his righteousness at the present time, so that he would be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for today. I thank you for that sun that's shining. It's just a reminder of the glory that we will see in you when we're in heaven. Lord, you have justified us through our faith in you. I thank you that we get to serve such an amazing God and that our joy in serving you comes from you. I pray for our message today and our guests that are here. In loving name we pray. Amen.
We have the privilege this morning to sing great truths about who our God is, as his word has prepared the soil of our hearts. May we respond now in talking about his greatness, talking about his character. So we're going to sing about his faithfulness, that forever God is faithful, forever he is strong. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise,
changed. You never fail, oh God. True are your promises. True are your promises. You never change. You never fail, oh God. So we raise up holy hands to praise the Holy One who was and is and is to come. Wide is your love and grace. Wide is your love and grace. You never change. You never fail.
Rest, not in our feelings, not in our circumstances, but in the solid rock of your word and the message of God, what you have done through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, because you are faithful, Lord, our peace, our confidence, our hope is rock solid. No matter what happens in this life, God, we can trust you, which causes us to want to praise you, to raise our hands, Lord, to cry out that you are the God who was and is to come. Great is your faithfulness, Lord. Great is your faithfulness and your promises to We ask that, Lord, now that as we come to worship you, continue our worship service, help us now to worship you in our attention to hearing your word preached. Lord, we would be able to listen and be doers of your word and apply your word to our hearts, that it may be an act of worship in our attention, in our attentiveness, in our listening, an act of worship. And we pray for our brother Joel, that, Lord, as he comes and ministers to us, I pray that, God, you would give him clarity of thought and speech, that you move by your Holy Spirit through him powerfully to preach your word, that your saints would be edified, that we'd be built up so that, God, we can apply and live a life, a living life of worship before you, a living sacrifice, God. We thank you for this morning. We bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's an honor to be here to share the word with you today. As Dave mentioned already, we serve together at Heartstone, so it's a joy to be here. And for those of you who don't know, Dave knew me back when I was still just a teenager, and he discipled me and my wife, when we were dating at the time. He and his wife, Julie, had just a huge impact on our life. So it's a wonderful joy to be here with you all and to share the word. Thank you, Dave. So, the passage we're going to be studying this morning is what we read for the call to worship, Romans chapter 3. So if you still have that, you can stay there, stay put, or turn back to Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 26. Before we dig in more, though, one thing's important when understanding this passage and in ourselves, and it's this, that it's very difficult for every single one of us to admit that we're wrong, isn't it? I don't know about you, but the littlest things, I'm going to put so you can see my face. So the littlest things are hard to admit, aren't they? I mean, driving down the freeway, you miss a turn. I knew that. I'm watching the road, honey. Come on. Trying to fess up on the smallest stuff is difficult for us. And we've all seen it easily in other people. It's hard to admit you're wrong in an argument or made the smallest mistake. It's hard to say, I was wrong, please forgive me. Now just think, if it's hard enough for us to admit our smallest faults, how much harder would it be for us to admit the real ones, the big ones, the most secret sins? Can we really trust ourselves to do that? I'm so thankful that the Gideons are here today and sharing that story, Rick, of preaching the gospel in grocery lines. Because I can tell you this, if you ask someone in a grocery line at Costco, what do you think? Are you a good person? Their answer almost always will be yes. Yes, I am. Well, why? And generally, they'll either say, because I do this, this, and this, or I don't do this or that. I'm not a drug dealer. I'm not an adulterer. I'm not a thief. I provide for my family. In every case, people will always point to some kind of law or standard that they think that they keep. And so that is why God gave us the book of Romans, and that is why the Apostle Paul in this book over and over again establishes this truth that not one of us is righteous. Not one of us. So with that, just some background on the book of Romans and our passage. The author is Paul the Apostle. He says in chapter 1 that he's a servant of God, a minister of the gospel. And he's writing to the church in Rome, the Roman church. And the interesting thing is he had never met them yet. So that's actually why this book is one of the biggest letters in the New Testament. He hadn't met them, and unlike other churches where he had gone and shared the gospel and taught them for months up or a few years, since he hadn't seen them face to face, he has to put all the important stuff, all the key things about the gospel in this letter. Paul didn't want them to miss out on what he had to teach them, what God had for them in the gospel. So he's writing to them, explaining the gospel, and he's writing to all kinds of people in this church. There's Jewish Christians, people who had grown up hearing all the stories in the Old Testament. They knew the law. They knew the promises. And then he's also writing to other people, Gentiles, who had never heard any of this before. They knew they were sinners, and they repented, and they turned to Jesus, but they didn't have all this background and culture, church culture, we might say. They didn't have all that. They weren't church kids. They came right off the street to Christ. And so Paul is sharing this message for all of them and explaining to all of them what Christ is for them. And one thing we see in our passage, and the most important thing is this, that Paul is sharing with them, that the only way for you to be righteous with God, the only way for you to be right with God is through Jesus' payment for your sin. And that's the main point of this passage, and it's the main point of the book of Romans as well. And get this, it's the only way for everyone. It's that way for the people who grew up in the covenant, who knew the promises, and it's the same for the people who came right off the street and trusting in Christ. The only way is through Christ. So, one other thing, in order to understand that and to understand the words Paul's using here, he does use a few words we don't use very often, like propitiation or redemption. So to understand those words, Paul is trying to teach them that Christ is their propitiation. So the definition for that is atonement. Right here, right in the middle of this passage, Paul says that Christ is the propitiation by his blood. And that's the key. He's our atonement. So we're going to look more at that. Now, what we see first in this message of the gospel is that the gospel is different from the law. The gospel is different from the law. He says that in verse 21. He says, now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. The righteousness of God, the righteousness that he gives to us is manifested apart from the law. But the law and prophets bear witness to it. Now what's so important to get here is that the gospel is different. The way we think about being right with God, you know, doing good things, being a good person, following the rules, that's not how we can be righteous with God. Just the verse before, verse 20, Paul says, for by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight. By works of the law, by obedience, we can't be justified because through the law comes knowledge of sin. So what can happen, though, in our thinking is we confuse the law and the gospel. We confuse obedience and being right with God. And we think, oh, if I just do this, if I just do this action, then I'm acceptable before God. Then God will say yes to me and I can go to heaven. It's so natural to our thinking to think this way. And Paul is saying, no, you cannot obey the law. And you cannot obey the law in order to go to heaven. Because the law shows you that you're a sinner in need of a perfect sacrifice. If I were to leave today and go drive down State Street and say I'm driving just recklessly, 80 miles an hour, and I hit someone, take their life. No amount of safe, careful driving after that would make up for the fact that I killed that man. I can't make up for that by trying to follow traffic rules after I've already broken the law. You see that? So in the same way, Paul is saying, you have broken God's law. The law shows you that. You are a sinner, and nothing you can do can make you righteous. And so first we see that the gospel is different from the law. We need something different than rule-keeping because we've already broken the rules. So much trouble for us, for the whole world, and for Christians come when we confuse the law and the gospel. Paul says in verse 19 of this passage, he says, whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, and notice the purpose, so that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. So God gives us his law in order to stop our mouths, to stop the excuses and say, look, you're not good enough. Do you remember the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus preached? In Matthew 5 through 7, so many of the people who were hearing him, they were people in the covenant of God. They were God's people, and they thought they were good law keepers. And he said, you've heard, don't murder. But I tell you, if you hate someone, if you're angry with your brother, you've murdered him. Oh, and you think you're not an adulterer because you haven't committed adultery, you haven't done the act? If you look at a woman with lustful intent, you've broken the law. So Christ he never lowered the law. He actually explained it and said, you aren't keeping it. You are lowering the law by trying to keep it. You lower the standard so you can pass the test. And so here too, the Apostle Paul is bringing the law forward first. He brings the law forward first and explains it and says, you can't keep it. You need the gospel. So until we get both the law right, we can't even get the gospel right. If we confuse the two, we come to Christ thinking we do it. We receive what he has by faith, and we also have to sort of do it ourselves so he still likes us. That causes so much trouble in our souls, doesn't it? And it also keeps a lot of those people on the streets, it keeps them on the streets. Because if we have to clean ourselves up before coming to Christ, why on earth could they come and be with us in the church if they're not good enough? And they have to clean themselves up first. And also, Paul in chapter 3 says, All are under sin, both Jews and Greeks. He says that in verse 9. What then, are we Jews any better off? No, not at all, for we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. Everyone is. No matter your culture, no matter the color of your skin, there's not a, you can't tell the good guys and the bad guys by what you look like. Every single one of us is guilty before God. He says that again in verse 23, for all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. And that brings us to the next point, that everyone needs the gospel, right? So the law is different than the gospel. We need to remember that. We need Christ. And the next point, everyone needs the gospel. Everyone needs this righteousness that God gives through Christ. There aren't different groups of people, some who need the gospel and others who don't. That's why he says there's no distinction. He's been writing to these different people saying, you all are guilty before God. Everyone alike. And this is very repetitive, and I repeat myself, but only because that is what Paul does as well. Because it's so hard for us to believe. We hear it, and then we go home, and then on Tuesday, we start law-keeping again, don't we? We start trying to make God happy with us all over again. And Paul is saying here, no, you can't do that. There is no distinction. Every one of us has fallen short of the glory of God. And notice that too. He says, all of us have sinned and we all fall short of the glory of God. He ties those two ideas together. He says earlier in chapter 1 that people actually exchange the truth about God for a lie. And they exchange God's glory, his glory, for other things in this world. And think of this. So glory, definition, glory is, in one way, the weight of righteousness. When you see something glorious, there's this sense of beauty and wonder that comes with something being the way it should be. So we know God is glorious, and his goodness and righteousness and justice are praiseworthy. That's the idea behind glory. It's praiseworthy. In the same way, when Christ, the perfect man, comes and obeys God's law, there is glory that comes with it. There's a sense of worship. We want to praise him for that. Notice even in chapter 2, Paul says in verse 6, he says, God will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he gives eternal life. So he even says here, if you obey, if you actually follow God righteously and follow his law perfectly, there is glory that comes from that. But guess what? None of you have done that. No, I haven't done that. Only Christ has come and obeyed the law perfectly. And so he's worthy of that glory. That's what it means when he says we fall short of that glory. We're not the way we're supposed to be. We're broken. We fall short of God's plan. But the wonder of it all is that just as much as we have fallen short of God's glory, the next verse says, and are justified by his grace as a gift. He ties those two ideas together. Just as we fall short of the glory of God, and we have all sinned, so God, he says in the next verse, justifies us by his grace as a gift. He doesn't leave us in the first position. He responds by justifying us by his grace. Everyone needs this. Everyone needs this. And this is why Paul also says that the law itself and the prophets bear witness to the gospel. Remember, the law is different than the gospel. The Ten Commandments can't save you. Christ obeyed them, and his righteousness, he fulfills the law. But even in the law, it points to Christ. That's why in verse 21, he says, the law and the prophets bear witness to Christ. The law and the prophets point to Christ because we can't do it ourselves. Now, think with me here. We all have fallen short. We all feel the weight of our sin one way or another. And it shows up in all kinds of ways. It shows up in maybe a man trying to be just the perfect dad, right? That's a good thing, right? That's God made us to want to be that. And yet we can try so hard to do what is right and slave away to justify ourselves and also cover up then when we've made the mistakes and not actually followed through like we were supposed to. Other people feel the weight of their sin pressed down on them so much they fall into depression and guilt and anxiety. And think with me here. In verse 25, God tells us that he put Christ forward as a propitiation by his blood. So blood is required. A life for life is required by the law. And we feel that. And we might not get it logically. We might not understand some of these concepts in the abstract. But we understand this in our bones. That's why many of our young people cut themselves and spill their blood, because they feel the weight of their own sin and the law on them. It's bearing witness in their heart, and the guilt and the shame they feel is causing them to even harm themselves, because there is a real reality pressing in on them, and that is why we all need the gospel. That's why others take their own life, because the weight of their sin and shame presses down on them. And that's why others fly planes into buildings, because they try to justify themselves in harming others and putting that weight of sin and guilt on someone else and blaming them, right? That's why there's so much wickedness in the world. We all have fallen short. I don't care if you're a Sunday school teacher. God doesn't care about that. That doesn't justify you before God any more than the drug addict. Not one of us can. All we can bring is our sin before Christ. And every single one of us can be justified by his grace as a gift. As a gift. That's why in chapter 4, Paul says in verse 4, "Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness." There's two options. You can take the law yourself and pay the bill. You can get your wage, or you can trust in the work of another, in Christ. And he even says here, the wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. You earn it. That's why Paul can also say that the wages of sin is death. So if you want to take the wage, if you want to get what you deserve and have earned, it's death. And we know this. We know this for those of us in the church. We hear this week after week. We read it in our Bibles. But so often, we can fall back into trying to earn our wage instead of receiving the gift that God has for us in Christ. And then the good news is no longer good news. So third, the gospel is not what you do, but what God has already done. A lot of well-meaning people will say, let's do the gospel. Let's live the gospel. Now, we can live in light of the gospel, but we don't actually do the gospel. It's done. It's news. It's a message that has already been done and given to you. Christ has come. Christ has come. God, the Father sent the Son for you, and he has accomplished it. It's not about what you have done or can do, but what God has done. Notice first in our passage that it comes from God the Father. He is the author of this righteousness. That's why Paul calls it in both verse 21 and verse 22, the righteousness of God, or you could say from God. He's the one who authors it. He is the source of this rightness, this righteousness. And he is the one who also declares us righteous by his grace. That's what it means when it says that we're justified by his grace. To be justified is to be declared not guilty. To be not guilty of the charge. And here Paul says that God the Father justifies us by his grace, not by our works. By his own favor and love, he looks at you and says, not guilty. Not guilty. Just as we fall short of God's glory, so we also are justified by his grace. That's why Paul says in the beginning of this chapter that even our unrighteousness serves to show the righteousness of God. Even our sin. Think of that video we watched earlier. Was not God glorified in that man's story? Ultimately, his unrighteousness did show the righteousness of God because God forgave him and changed him. Now, what else does the Father do? He's a gift giver. Just like you love to give gifts to your children and grandchildren, God's an even better gift giver than you are, isn't he? He gives us this righteousness, this grace as a gift. And he provides Jesus as our sacrifice. The verse 25 says that God put him forward, or your translation may say displayed him publicly. This wasn't done in a corner. God publicly put Jesus forward as a gift. He offered him up. God the Father made a plan for you to save you. It's not like Jesus was up in heaven begging this angry, grumpy God, God, Father, let's save them, please. And God says, okay, fine, you can save them, I guess. No, God the Father made a plan to save you, and he loves you. He really does. And then this gospel, it's accomplished in Jesus Christ. He is the one who has done the gospel, not you. You don't do it. He does it, and it's done. We believe it, and we preach it. We tell other people what he has done. He is the one that we trust in. Verse 22 says that this righteousness is through faith in Jesus Christ. He's the object. He's the one that we're putting our trust in. And even our faith, it's not about our faith. It's not about our faith as if we have to have the biggest, greatest faith in order to go to heaven. Elsewhere, Jesus says, if you have the faith even of a tiny mustard seed, you could say to the mountain, let it be cast over. People will twist that and make it all about you and your faith and get all weird about it. But Jesus, the point he's making is it's not even about you. It's about you holding on to me. You having faith in me. Even the smallest bit of faith in Jesus Christ is more than enough because he is more than enough. So he's the one we trust in, and he is the one who frees us from our slavery. I was trying to define some of those words earlier, redemption, propitiation, and then I realized I just need to, let's just jump into it and we can work through it here. So redemption, that's one of the words, one of the big words in this passage that we don't always use. More often than not, it shows up on our gift cards that we get for Christmas or birthdays, right? Would you like to redeem this gift card? Yes, please. Well, he is our redemption, and they're actually using that language. It's economic language. There's something that is owed. There's something that can be bought back. I'm trying to remember where I actually have the definition of it. To buy back, right? To pay a ransom. If somebody was kidnapped and enslaved, they would need to have someone pay the redemption price for them. So over and over again, Paul is saying that all of us are trapped under sin and under the slavery of sin, and Christ has paid the redemption price for it. The slave doesn't free themselves, and Jesus comes and frees them. So he is the one that pays the redemption price. And he's the one that takes all the wrath of God on the cross. That's what it means by propitiation. He is our propitiation. God put him forward and put all of the righteous, good wrath and anger for our sin got put on Jesus. This word is also used elsewhere to describe the mercy seat, the one that was on the Ark of the Covenant. On the Day of Atonement, the priest would come and sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice over this mercy seat. And that was the way that we knew we can be right with God. Through the blood, there's a payment made, an atonement
is made, and now we can be right with God. And then the presence of God was on the mercy seat as well when that sacrifice was made. And so that was just a picture pointing us to what really happened, which was at the cross, that Jesus Christ paid the redemption price. He actually paid for all of the guilt that you really did have. He actually paid for every bit of it. And again, Paul doesn't lessen the law in order to magnify the gospel. You don't have to do that. We really are sinners, and God really is gracious. Both of those realities are true. We really have fallen short of the glory of God. There really is a great weight of sin that each one of us carries, a great burden, and we actually need it to be removed. Our culture today gives us a false gospel when they try to say, you're not a sinner. You're just wonderful. You're just great. No, we really are broken. We really have fallen short. And God really has paid the price and has taken all that wrath and put it on Christ, and it's paid for. Now, none of us would want to admit this, but so often we can struggle to see God as our Father, as a good Father. None of us would want to say it, but sometimes we can view him as distant and aloof. We can picture him as mad dad, who's just always disappointed with us, always saying, why can't you be more like your older brother, Jesus? Some of us can be tempted to feel that way about God. I just need to be more like Christ today. And here in this passage, and in all throughout the gospel, God is saying, no, I've given my best for you because you need it, and I love you. That's why Paul says here that God is doing this to show his righteousness. He's wanting to show us just how much he loves us and how good he is. That's our next point, is that in the gospel, God... In verse 25, at the very end of the verse, Paul says, this is to show God's righteousness. All of what he has done in the gospel is to show his divine forbearance. Because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins. He wants us to see that he has been patient. That he, in our sin, has patiently waited for this time of the cross to pay for it. In the gospel, he shows us how good he is to us. And he isn't being a divine show-off either. He's doing this because we need to know that about him, even for our own sake and for the sake of his glory. Unfortunately, what can make this difficult to understand for some of us is when we read about righteousness, we think of the bad version. We think of self-righteousness. We think of someone who's very puffed up and proud and full of themselves. And so, unfortunately, some folks will hear about the righteousness of God and they'll get this wrong view in their mind that God is this cold, hard, righteous person. But no, his righteousness, as I said earlier, it's his goodness, it's his faithfulness, his love, his purity. Even in the law, which points to the gospel, right? It bears witness to it. When Moses told God, he said, show me your glory. And when God marched before him and showed him his glory, he started by saying, the Lord, who's passionate, compassionate, merciful, full of loving kindness. God wants us to see that. And that's why in this righteousness that he's manifested in the gospel, he shows us his mercy and his grace. Now here in verses 25 and 26, Paul explains further the purpose of the gospel is to show God's goodness and his love for us. He speaks first of former sins and even the present time. In the time before the cross, God had patiently been waiting and bearing with the sins of his people. And he even says he passed over those former sins. Just like the Passover that many of you know of, when the blood of the lamb was put over the door frame. And the angel of death passed over those houses. The judgment didn't fall because a perfect sacrifice had been made. God had been passing over the former sins of his people, waiting for the day to put Christ on the cross to pay for that sin. And then Paul says, in the present time, he continues to show himself to be just. He is just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Christ Jesus. So here he's speaking of redemptive history. He's speaking of all that God had done, big picture throughout all of human history. But think of your own history. Think about how patient God had been before you came to the cross. How many times could you have gone so much farther into complete destruction? How many times were you this close to being damned to hell, to falling off the edge, to dying and being fully worthy of Christ's judgment? How many times has God been patient with us before we even knew about him? He was patient with our ignorance, waiting for that day when to draw us to himself. And then in the present time, even in our life now, he shows himself to be right and just and the one who justifies. Again, it's him doing the work. It's him making us like his son, Jesus. It's him declaring us righteous. And he wants you to know that. He does that for his own sake and glory. The Father really does want to glorify the Son, and the Son wants to honor and glorify the Father. Now, the Holy Spirit isn't mentioned here in these verses, but just a couple chapters later in chapter 5, Paul says that the Holy Spirit is poured into our heart, and the love of God is poured into our heart through the Holy Spirit. So God is working, and he's glorifying himself within the Trinity, and he also wants us to know these things for our sake, too. He wants us to know this so that we can receive these things by faith. Throughout these verses, Paul says again and again that this is by faith and through faith that we receive these promises. We trust and believe that God really is who he says he is. And we also really do believe that we are who he says he is before we came to him, but also after, too. Before we came to him, we were in chapter 3, verse 10. None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. That's where we once were. And God now, though, has made us righteous in Christ. Turn with me over to chapter 5. Chapter 5, verse 1. Paul says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Before we didn't, before we really did have the weight of shame and guilt on us, before we were guilty and deserving of all of God's punishment, but now we have peace with him. And through him, we obtain access by faith in the grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. That's where we are now, and we get to rejoice and have hope and glory in God. And God wants us to know this. And so he tells us every day just a little bit more about himself, how good he is, how much he loves you. And now we have peace with him so we can follow him. And then we can say, okay, what I love you so much. What can I do, God? How can I honor you, my Father? And that's the way that we relate to him now. Paul asks a very important question, and this is the logical conclusion of all these things. Back in our passage in chapter 3, after saying all these things, Paul moves on to say in verse 27, then what becomes of our boasting? We have nothing to brag about, brothers and sisters, and that's a wonderful place to be in, isn't it? We don't have to worry about glorifying ourselves. We don't have to cover up our sin. That's why John says in 1 John, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. We can go back to him again and again. And like he says here, I am just and I am the justifier, not you. I make you right. Come to me. That's why Jesus can say, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. I will give you rest. You can have peace with God. The best you can do, even now as a believer, the best you can do and all you can do is just rely on him. And even that, Paul says elsewhere, is a gift. Even that is a gift, that faith you have. And all the glory goes to Jesus. All the glory goes to the Father and to the Spirit. What becomes of our boasting is excluded by what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by the law of faith. We live by faith now. For we hold, verse 28, that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. So then what does that look like in our life? It means that we don't have to constantly run back to all the self-help books and all the Christian living books. While there's many good truths in there, so much of that can be motivated, and so often we can be wrongly motivated to try to be right with God through our obedience. We can try to learn the next new thing, try to learn the next new system, just memorize a few more verses, read a little bit more of my Bible, and now God is happy with me. No, because even that, God tells us, I've saved you, I love you, I've redeemed you, I want to talk to you. And I want to hear you so you can pray to me. That's the way God relates to us now. The law is do this and live. The gospel is it's done. And you are alive because I made you alive. So you get to live with me now. That's the gospel. So even here on this Communion Sunday, because of this wonderful gospel, we get to celebrate it. And we get to proclaim the Lord's death. When he took the cup, he said, do this in remembrance of me. This cup is the cup, the new covenant of my blood. So when you drink it, you're remembering and receiving my gift to you, my blood that I shed for you. So that's what we do when we drink the cup. And when we eat the bread, we remember his broken body, that he took the wounds that we deserve. We deserved to be on that cross. We deserve for God to be angry with us. We really have sinned. And yet God says, no, I made a way and I love you. So when we take this communion now, it's a celebration more than anything else. It's a celebration. And when Paul explains it further and rebukes the Corinthians for how they were taking communion, just remember, they were getting drunk at church. They did need a rebuke. There were factions and divisions. There was sexual immorality. There's all kinds of wickedness going on in that church. So Paul does rebuke them, and he says, examine yourselves. So we do examine ourselves when we come before him. But even for the worst of the sinners in that church, he says to them, examine yourselves to see if you're in the faith. Not examine yourselves to see if you made it this week and can take communion, but examine yourselves, are you trusting in Jesus? So for the legalist, you take communion and you have to say, no, not I, but Christ. And in the same way, if you were like one of the Corinthians, and if you really are in a lot of secret sin and trapped, how do you come to the table? How do you examine yourself? You remember that Christ died for that sin and freed you from it, and you don't have to go back to it. And so as Paul says in Romans 6, how can we who died to sin still live in it? How can we do that? Because he's so good, he's freed us. So when we take communion right now, as Brother Dave leads us in it, we rejoice. And so think on the faith, think on God's promises, and do examine yourself in light of what God has done, what he says about you. Let's pray. Lord in heaven, thank you that you have provided for us this wonderful gospel. Thank you that it's for your glory. Thank you that not only do we not have to glorify ourselves and make ourselves glorious, you have glorified yourself in the gospel, and you have called us to glory in you. Thank you that you are good and faithful. Thank you, Christ, that you've spilled your blood for us and that you've given us life. Thank you that we get to declare you and declare your praises and your glory, whether we're taking communion or whether we're having conversations this week. Lord, help us to honor and glorify you. Thank you that you don't need us, but you accept us. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel, for bringing the word to us this morning. I hope you were encouraged that the gospel is done. Amen. That we have been redeemed. The wrath of God has been satisfied, appeased. And because of what he has accomplished for us, we get to come to the table this morning. We get to remember him. Last week, we celebrated Good Friday. We celebrated Resurrection Sunday. And right before that, on Friday night, Jesus met with his disciples. The famous Upper Room Discourse. And he instituted an ordinance that we call in the church an ordinance, which is called communion. Some call it the sacraments or the Lord's table. And as Joel shared with us, it was a time of celebration. It was a time, this is going to be the last meal that Jesus is getting ready to have with his disciples. And he wanted them to have something to remember him by. And it's interesting because we do this every month, right? And I love that we can always look at communion from a different angle. But the Lord Jesus wants us to remember the love the Father has for us and the work that he has accomplished for us. And he gave us a tangible reminder. When I was a kid, I had the opportunity, my parents took me down to Southern California, and they took us to Disneyland, and I remember getting into the parking garage, and we parked, and there was this forever walk to get to the front of the theme park, and as we were walking there, my dad pulled out a bag of chili cheese Fritos, and it was the first time in my life that I'd ever had chili cheese Frito, all right? I remember eating that, and it was like, oh, these are so good. And so every time when I go in the grocery store and I see a bag of chili cheese Fritos, you know what I think of? I think of my vacation to Disneyland with my dad when I was a kid. Because there was a tangible association in my mind. In the same way, that's what Jesus Christ is doing with his disciples and for the future of his church. That he doesn't want us just to read about him, right, and to hear his word. But he wants to have a tangible physical reminder that I am with you. I have paid for your sin in full. It is finished. It is done. You're not guilty. You now have my righteousness. And he sets us free now to enjoy and delight in him. And so the table is a time of reflection. And we don't just sit here and say, how many sins did I do this last week? And Brother Joe, I thank you for helping us see that. Because it's not, we're examining ourselves to see, how am I doing? No, my faith is caught. Am I still trusting in Christ? Christ, you took care of it. I'm good. The relationship is good, right? So we're celebrating in our position that Christ has paid it all. There's a quote that I just came across recently. Stephen, if you want to put this up on the screen. This is an old Scottish reformer, Puritan, and he said this, and I thought it would be appropriate before we take the elements this morning. He said, you're able to find that. The word leads us to Christ by the ear. Next. The communion table, the sacraments, leads us to Christ by the eye. And what I want to do, I want us to bow our heads and close our eyes, and I want you to hear our Lord's words as he's in the upper room and he's talking to his disciples this Friday night before he's getting ready to be betrayed, right? And I want you to hear his heart. And we're going to hear the word, but then we're going to come to look with our eye at the table, that tangible reminder of his presence here with us this morning. So would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me as I read this portion of the upper room from Matthew 26. While they were eating, Jesus took some bread. And after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And when he had taken the cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you, for many, for the forgiveness of sins. And I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I will drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. And after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. We look up for a moment. I want to just take a couple quick things from this. One of the things that Jesus did as he instituted the sacrament of the Lord's table, taking communion together, was that he took the bread and he asked a blessing. This is part of the reason why Christians, why we pray. We have that modeled for us. We pray before a meal to give thanks to whom thanks is due. And he took the cup and he gave thanks. And what I want to do now, I want to pray and ask a cup of a blessing upon the cup and the bread. And then when we finish taking communion together, I want to copy our Lord and disciples, and I want to sing a hymn. And they actually sang this hymn, and they left and went to the Mount of Olives right after this upper room. We're not going to go to the Mount of Olives today, but we're going to close our service with a hymn. So let me ask a blessing on our communion time, and then we'll take the elements. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to have your word. We thank you that, God, the truth of Scripture has informed us of who you are. Lord, as we look at Romans 3 this morning, man can't think this up. Man in his natural state wants to glorify himself. The Bible is the most degrading book about man because it tells us straight up that, God, who we are and who you are. And we thank you that, God, we can come to you with all of our guilt, all of our shame, all of our sin, and knowing that, God, we're not trying to dumb it down. This is who we are. All we bring to the table is our sin. And we cry out, hallelujah, for such a Savior that you have taken care of all of our sin. And we worship you this morning. We thank you for this great gospel, this great news that comes from your Bible, this special revelation. And we thank you for the modeling that you show us that how we can give thanks to you. Thanks for our meals. Thanks for all the wonderful gifts in life. And specifically this morning as we close our service and looking at the table, Lord, we thank you that your body was broken on that tree. That you took the death penalty that each one of us deserve. That you were crushed for our iniquities. We thank you that you spilt your blood. That you, shortly after this, were getting ready to go to the garden and to cry out in prayer to your Father, may this cup pass. That symbolic cup representing the cup of wrath that, Lord Jesus, you drank for each one of us. Every drop you took with propitiation, the wrath that we deserve for our sins. Jesus, you satisfied the demands of the law. You satisfied the anger and curse and the wrath that our sin deserves. And you spilled out your blood to the point of death on the cross. For the joy set before you, you did that. So we ask your blessing now upon these two elements. We thank you for the opportunity to have a tangible remembrance. And when we see these elements, it knows that God, we know you're here with us. And it causes us to not just know you by ear, but to know you by eye. We thank you, Lord, in your name. Amen. If you would like to grab the elements next to you, the tables. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he had broken it and said to said this, "This is my body which has been broken for you. Take this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us close this morning by singing a hymn. And I would like to sing it a cappella, just because we don't do that very often, and I just love hearing voices. Sometimes just less is more, whatever, how that saying goes. So Steve, if you'd like to put that up there for us, you can follow me. "Should nothing of our effort stand, no legacy survive, unless the Lord does raise the house, in vain its builders strive. To you who boast tomorrow's gain, tell me, what is your life? Our prayer that all Christ would receive all the glory, all the praise for God, what you in the Trinity God had ordained and decided before time even began, that you would redeem a people for yourself. We delight in you. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for remembrance of the table. Lord, we love you. We worship you. Go with us this week now. In your name we pray. Amen. Have a wonderful week.